I'm Willy Zenter, faculty member of the New School for Social Research and Research Associate at the CIPA. This is the Schwarz Center for Economic Policy Analysis, dealing with a big important topic of all time. And I direct there some research on climate change. And the idea was that we do now, we team up a little bit with Potsdam University, and Professor Galitzky was so friendly to help to organize the Fortnum part here. Professor Sujin will give some introduction. She's the dean. Just one more. I want to welcome to the audience, colleagues from Fortnum, colleagues from the New School, and some of you know me. We have done this event on climate economics several times, once a semester. It's funded by the Thyssen Foundation and also German Science Foundation, German Council, and others. And this time we have an excellent presentation, as you will see. I will introduce Professor Naki Senovic. He likes to be called Professor Naki. It's easier to pronounce.
Trust
me. I think now we can start with an introduction of Professor Sujin now from Fortnum University. She is the dean of the law school here. So welcome.
It's really my pleasure to welcome you to Fordham Law School. We are really honored to be hosting this important event. Today's discussion on the transition to a low carbon economy and how to finance it is of particular importance to us here at Fordham. It marks what we hope is the beginning of a partnership between two institutions strongly devoted to supporting research on climate change and proposing pragmatic solutions. Fordham Law School has long been involved in promoting environmental law research. Our environmental law review is one of the most cited in the country. Our faculty, particularly Professor Galitzky, has been very active in research and teaching in this field. And we have hosted several programs in environmental studies, both in the law school and throughout the rest of the university. So I feel like we are a good home for this program, and I hope you feel at home here. I'm grateful that the Schwarz Center for Economic Policy and Analysis at the New School has decided to partner with our own Sustainable Development Legal Initiative to bring today's panel discussion to Fordham. I want to particularly acknowledge the amazing work that Professor Galitzky has done, leading the law school's work on sustainable development, his work both on the ground for communities and for our students here at the law school are really exemplary. And I also want to thank the people who made this event possible, and that includes my colleague, Professor Martin Gelter, who has made the introduction, and of course, Professor Semler, director of the Schwarz Center for Economic Policy and Analysis, Economics and Climate Change Project. Now, we are fortunate today to have with us, and I'm so glad to hear that you'd like to be called Professor Naki, because I'm going to mispronounce your name. So we are so happy to have you here, Deputy Director of the International Institute of Applied System Analysis, a globally recognized leading authority on climate policy. I really look forward to your remarks. Today's discussion could not be more timely. Climate change is an increasingly central topic, both in our country and worldwide. Recent tragic natural events, like Hurricanes Harvey and Irma, have highlighted the growing threats posed by climate change to our livelihoods and our planet. This week, as you all know, if you tried to take a taxi, across the city at the United Nations headquarters, climate change is at the center of diplomatic conversations among heads of state and governments gathered here in New York for the 72nd session of the General Assembly. The international community's efforts to address climate change were codified in the landmark 1992 United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, followed by the 1997 Kyoto Protocol and the 2015 Paris Agreement. Alongside action at the global level and often spurred by international agreements, countless initiatives are now taking place at the regional, sub-regional, national, and all the way to the local level, the which of course is very important in this country because, as you know, the U.S. President has unfortunately indicated that he plans to abandon the Paris Agreement. And that agreement really lays out the roadmap for the transition to a low-carbon economy. Many cities and states are trying to meet our expectations. The shift from our current economic model will require significant but doable changes. A central, if not the central critical question that needs to be addressed now is the one that we are discussing today. How to finance such a transition. One of the arguments made by President Trump to explain the U.S. withdrawal from the Paris Agreement was its economic cost and potential negative impacts on the U.S. economy. This argument, though, has been debunked by scholars and experts on climate policy, and indeed, many are suggesting that climate change may provide economic opportunities for growth and the move to a greener economy. I'm a tax scholar. We spend a lot of time focusing on carbon taxes and how they would really produce benefits in many different ways. And so I'm particularly interested in hearing about the role that taxation might play in encouraging or facilitating a transition to a low carbon economy. And I look forward to this discussion.
Such a wonderful introduction to the topic already. Usually one has a certain perspective in this area, but it was a completely different perspective, and I'm grateful that we get also some other perspectives in. Now I want to introduce Professor Nagy. We are all friends, we know each other for a pretty long time. He has basically three great abilities. One is a great scholar, secondly is a great administrator, and third he is a great economic advisor of governments, multinational institutions on climate issues and global issues. So combining all three, he is very effective. He is trained as an economist and or engineer or computer scientist, BA and MA from Princeton University and University of Vienna. He was a professor at the University of Vienna for energy economics. He took over then, worked for a long time for the YASA. This is the International Institute for Applied System Analysis, which was founded actually in the 1960s already by President Johnson and some Russian head of states to solve problems of the real world and not doing this Cold War game strategies. And that's where the YASA started. And now YASA has hundreds of researchers and is, so to speak, the powerful research institution which is behind the global development goals of the UN. Does a lot of research on the water, population, environment, effects of trade, renewable energy. This is a particular big area there. And Professor Nagy is also a great academic. He wrote about 250-300 scientific academic papers. He's on 6 or 7 boards of journals. He is doing active research. We're doing some of the research together. But in his particular role is advisor, besides being the deputy Director General of the YASA and also the Deputy Chief Executive Officer of the YASA, of this great institution of hundreds of researchers. This is his administrative talent, so to speak. It's pretty challenging. He is an advisor of the Secretary General of the United Nations on global issues and climate issues and technology. He is have advisory jobs for the World Bank, for International Council for Science and Climate. He's also the Earth Institute advisor, International Science Panel on Renewable Energies, and his advisors of government, for example, the German government on global issues and environment. So, as you can see, other countries need great advisors for complicated issues. We in the US here recently don't need any advisors. You just do it very erratically and wipe out everything what has been achieved by science and academics and advising. And it was in the US in particular, or Roosevelt, who introduced scientific advisors into parliamentary laws that were passed by parliament. And the role of advisors is not to be underestimated, to get things right, right, in regulation and in laws and in behavioral rules that the parliament set. So this is his third, so to speak, great talent, being an advisor traveling around the world. We're meeting in all kinds of cities, New York or Vienna, and so he's very active. Recently he was at the UN discussion in the recent days here, unfortunately it's a World Bank. So, but today is a topic, transition to a low carbon economy and how to finance it. Now, it was already introduced, how to phase in a green economy, less carbon intensive economy. Well, there are three ways. One is taxation, which was discussed, so this is, so to speak, discussed a lot. So carbon tax, you set incentives, and people should respond to those incentives. Carbon intensive fossil fuel energy more expensive, less carbon renewable energy less less expensive, so you would substitute. This one way, though this way, the road is very long, very takes a long time to have effective results. The second way is, well, just scale up the investment on infrastructure, renewable energy, solar, wind, and other renewable energy. So basically, large scale investment, step in, needs a big public sector. But the third way is this, that's partly done more by the Europeans, that is regulation. So you set regulation, rules, standards for cars, emission standards. California, the US states are doing this. The third way is really setting standards and rules, and consumers or firms have to follow those. This is the third way. And so I'm particularly happy to be here at the law school, where we probably will get a very nice comment from Professor Galitzi and maybe others participants here from the law school, particularly the role of standards and regulations. So I want to welcome with those remarks Professor Naki here. And,
thank you very much for this really kind introduction and for setting the stage. I will focus primarily on the issues of how the transformation or the next revolution, how can we transition from today's state of the world to the one that's a low carbon society, low carbon economy. And then I hope toward the end, I would like to say a few things about the investment requirements, and I hope in the discussion then we can focus on the financing. You know, already the question of the carbon tax came up, and that just reminded me of day before yesterday, I was at the World Economic Forum. They're meeting in parallel together with the General Assembly. The topic was really sustainable development goals, but most of this discussion was on climate change. And by the way, Al Gore gave an incredibly motivational talk. I was very impressed how much substance one could squeeze in short time. But you know, the CEOs who were there, I think almost unanimously with one voice said, you know, give us the regulatory mechanism. We are happy about the carbon tax. We can work with the carbon tax as long as we know that the policy is sustainable and it's going to be not changed from one day to the other, from one administration to the other. So I think that's important to keep in mind, that there are many, many actors that are willing to actually commit themselves to the transformational pathway. But, you know, there is just too much, I think, regulatory uncertainty. So, basically, having said that, let me just start before I go to my talk. That will be, essentially, I would like to give you a brief glimpse in the development, global development, you know, where we are coming from, where we are going through, and then focus on the issues of decarbonization and finish at the end with the investment issues. But before I go there, first of all, I would like to thank Horkheim Law School and also Willy and his colleagues for inviting me here. I'm delighted to be here. I've been asked to talk for about 40 minutes, 45 minutes. I hope I will not bore you. But before I go to the talk, I would just like to say a few words about EASA. I mean, Willy already mentioned EASA is a global research institute. And it's a child of the Cold War. That is, I think, quite interesting also today, as we have so many divides in the world. It's a child of the Cold War because President Johnson and Premier Kosygin of Soviet Union wanted to have a scientific forum outside of the UN system to talk about what is common to the two across the Iron Curtain, so to say, to the two superpowers, and then other countries that were allies also wanted to join, and that's how the institute was established. But then it's not working fine. So in any case, after the Cold War was over, there was an issue whether one would declare the victory and say, okay, the institute has done its job, there is a strong scientific collaboration, and close it down. President Clinton and Austrian Chancellor initiated that meeting that was in the mid-90s, I think in 95, when it was decided that EASA, since the most of the problems EASA was working are global in nature, like climate change, that the institute should continue working on global issues and become the true global institute, North and South. So now we have membership from all over the world, not just East, former East and West. And we are embarking on the new research agenda that, my word, would be a transformational research agenda. How do we embark on the next evolution toward a more sustainable future? You see here the flags. This is not a quiz, if you can guess which countries are members. But we have 23 members of the institute through the academies of sciences. So it's non-governmental, international, but independent. So, you know, we don't have a party line. And each scientist can say whatever she or he wants to say, can publish whatever. So we have it's a true scientific organization. But our focus is across the, if you wish, the pillars or the columns of the disciplines. It's interdisciplinary and transdisciplinary research. We work in-house. We have about 350 researchers on the premises, and we work with models, with big data, and do quite lots of assessments of the major global problems. We hope that our work is solution and policy oriented by using the tools of systems thinking. That's basically the institute. So that, I just wanted to give you that as a brief introduction of what I will be talking, because that's where my day job is, and I think that the institute is working on many of these issues, in particular climate change. So let's go back to the, you know, transformation or transition to low carbon economy. I think you've already heard from the dean the Paris meeting in 2015, COP20, I think was really, really pivotal. Actually, the president of the COP20 was also at this meeting that was organized here in parallel. You know, there is lots of worry. I would have to say that when Paris was negotiated, and here in September in New York, the Sustainable Development Goals, also 2015, and then financing was done in Addis just a couple of months before, we had these really three important, exceedingly ambitious agreements, unanimous from the global community. I thought we were at the brink of the transformation, but I'm afraid that I'm a little bit worried now going well below 2 degrees might be challenged. Hopefully there will be a counter-reaction. We'll see at COP23 in November in Bonn. The implications of these agreements are really deep, and that's what I really want to talk about. You know, going well below 2 degrees global warming might really mean that we need to achieve zero emissions by the mid-century or soon thereafter. I mean, one has to think about it. This is an enormous challenge. in terms of how to transform our economy, how to transform our lives, our values and lifestyles. The major mechanism of the Paris Agreement are these nationally determined contributions, but if one stacks them up, currently they are in the region of 2.73 degrees. They were no close to being below 2 degrees. So maybe the ambition level will increase. On the other hand, US leaving will not help unless other countries such as Germany, France, China, and so on pull even stronger together as an outcome. So, you know, I think that the fund, 100 billion, is part of that mechanism. I would argue, even though that fund is going to be eroded now when US pulls out for sure, you know, it's probably not going to be 100 billion, but my point is we need trillions. So we need 1,000 times more capital to move in the direction of this transformation. So that's what I would like to finish my talk with. So let me try to start with the following picture. It's a collection of pictures by Peter Menzel, and if you're not familiar with them, I would suggest go to the website and look at them. He photographs people with their things. So for example, with all of their belongings. This picture is a family in Darfur, a refugee family, with all of their food for a week. And the reason why I'm showing that, you know, when we talk about climate and the transformation, we cannot forget those people who have been, who are excluded. And this is a good picture, I think, that demonstrates vividly what does it mean to be excluded from the current development. You know, it's obviously vegetarian diet, only one bottle of filtered water for a week. There's some water behind that still needs to be processed. I mean, this is really bare bones existence. And again, you know, I think if you take a system perspective, one can argue this is not decoupled from climate problems, because Darfur and also Syria are affected by a serious drought. Crops don't grow. People, in particular young men, move to the cities. I think many have anticipated that Syria would have the problem of so many people moving into the cities. And so I'm not arguing that that's the main cause, but it is usually you need multiple causes. One of the important causes of this of the development that we have seen. So I think it's a telltale sign of also climate change being part of the geopolitics and other developments that I think do produce new divides in the world. Now let me contrast that with this picture. And that's a family from the part of the world that I come from, or where Willy comes from Germany. But I'm sure that US does not look much better. This is food for a week. Now, it's difficult to believe, because much of the food is thrown away. Some of you will be there longer than a week. But the point is that you can see these two pictures. And I think this is a kind of a core issue, I think, of development and consequently also of climate change, that we have 1.5 to 3 billion people who have too little, way too little, they're excluded, and then you have maybe 1 or 2 billion people who have too much. And in some ways, you know, the inequities in the world are also a barrier, I think, to the transformation that we are talking about. So I just wanted to mention that as an introduction. And, you know, on the bad day, my fear is that we might be living what you could call a fortress world. Walls are being built. I mean, don't think just about the wall to Mexico. I mean, we have many walls in Europe that have emerged just over the last 2 years, you know, around Hungary, around Austria. Many countries are building walls. And I think this is a new kind of divide. And I think when we think about the transformation, I think it is important to think in terms of the sustainable development in general, and climate is an important part of it. And I think it's not to be divided from sustainable development in general. So let me just start with a little bit longer perspective. I didn't prepare a very technical talk. Apologies for that. I thought that was not clear to me how diverse the audience would be. It's a little bit stylized. Did not resist the temptation to use a double log scale here, so please keep that in mind. On the horizontal scale, you have time before the present, so you're going a million years into the past. Vertical scale is number of people on the planet. I think that's a very important indication for the carrying capacity of the Earth. So as we were in the, you know, as when we were hunters and gatherers, the planet supported something on the order of a dozen million people or so. but something very special happened somewhere between 10,000 and 5,000 years ago, the so-called Neolithic Revolution, that really catapulted the humanity. We settled down, developed the agriculture, early civilization, so I would say that's the cradle of humanity in many ways. It is these last 5 to 10,000 years. And what is significant, according to the best estimates we have, the global population increased by a factor of 100. I mean, this is incredible. I mean, it is a long period of time, but a factor of 100. And then during the last 200 years, we had a really explosive industrial revolution, where the population increased by about a factor of 10. So we are now, I think, approaching 7.5 billion people in the world. So this is a significant number. We'll probably, to most of the projections, indicate 9 billion or so by the middle of the century. So 1.5 billion people will join the planet, and then we have to worry about 1 to 3 billion who are excluded today. So projecting the logarithmic scale into the future, I think, you know, the sustainability transformation might be associated with significantly lower population, curving to 9 billion, going down to 7 or so. But there is, of course, a possibility that fertility might increase again. It is declining everywhere in the world, that we might be pushing even further. And so this is one of the key drivers, and I think it's an very, very important to be aware that I think demographic changes are an inherent part of the development of our societies, and therefore also directly linked to the carbon footprint of humanity. So let me stay with the topic just for a few minutes. And here again, time into the past. You see here, last 100,000 years, the last cycle in the climate. The vertical scale is the global mean temperature. So you can see that it varied on the order of more than 5 degrees between the glacial periods and interglacial periods. And these cycles go very far back into the, you know, they're quite regular. Go back to 800,000 years in the past. But what I wanted to point out is if you draw a line somewhere with zero and we look at the last, essentially this period since the Neolithic Revolution occurred, the climate has been incredibly stable. This is the era of the Holocene, and I would strongly argue, and I'm not the only one there are many, many scientists who are arguing that it's not coincidental that agriculture and early civilization developed because the climate was not that variable during that period. So I think we are now under the danger of leaving the Holocene. I think that's the threat to which we are, and many scientists call it now Anthropocene to denote the fact that one species is determining the Earth system processes in many ways through our activities. So I'm just amplifying the same picture, just that you can see it more clearly. So the last, let's say, 8,000 years, 5,000 years, according to the paleo data, the climate has been quite stable. You can see essentially 1 degree variation. But keep in mind that since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution to today, we have increased the global mean temperature by almost 1 degree, over 0.9 degrees. That's the global mean. But for example, where I live in Austria, Austrian mean temperature has increased by 2 degrees, and most of it during the last 30 years or so. So the ecosystems are threatened, glaciers are threatened, and then if you look at the scenarios that the scientific community is producing, we are sort of on a vertically up, heading towards singularity, almost infinite increase. So this is why the deep transformation is really required to low carbon society, to avoid this, and maybe I'll then the last one on this topic. This is the Paris range, what we have agreed in Paris, essentially below 2 degrees. So that's roughly where the temperature would have to be stabilized. And as I said, we are almost there in terms of historical. You can see this kind of hockey stick going up. And let me just, then these are the scenarios that have been produced for the IPCC. I will say a few more words about that. I will not go into detail. Let me just, this triangle I've highlighted, that you can see that even the Paris range is not all that safe in course. That doesn't mean this is going to be a safe place, even if we achieve Paris. So I think this is the double challenge that we have. It's very difficult to achieve Paris, but even achieving it doesn't mean that if you're going to be entirely in the safe place. Just as examples, far left on your left, you have West Antarctic ice sheet is already threatened, on the right, coral reefs, and Alpine glaciers, I mentioned why, temperature is increasing much higher at a higher rate in the mountainous regions. So we have this kind of a double challenge, and in that sense, 2 degrees is a very symbolic number. I would say it's policy-derived number, but it's a symbolic number, a trade-off, a kind of trade-off between what can be done, thank you, what can be done, and how big the damages would be. So just a short, for next few minutes, a short review of what happened during the Industrial Revolution, because I think that's really important of thinking where we might be going next. Because the next transformation is not the only one in human history. We had the Neolithic transformation or revolution, and we had the Industrial Revolution, and it all started here, in my view. The Stockton-Darlington steam railway built in 1826, that was the beginning. Before that, we had mostly horse-driven railways that did exist. But this was really the beginning of steel and steam era. And I would just like to show you like a film, a number of slides showing you what really happened. So population, I already discussed, and the logarithmic scale. You can see here the linear scale, how the population increased. Then you can see that in the last 40, 50 years, we had incredible doublings. I mean, some people call it the great acceleration. But it's not just the population. We are over 7 billion, about 7.5. If we look at economic output, the World Bank says we are at about 80 trillion. I think the real GDP might be even higher. So also economic output increased exponentially. Energy use, we need about over 500 exajoules of energy, and we'll probably need more energy to connect everybody. The 3 billion people who do not have sustainable cooking, for example. Water use, as you can see, has increased by a factor of 4. Many say that water will be one of the critical resources. Transportation, as you all know, is one of the real crucial problems. Now, many countries are talking about forbidding regulatory mechanisms, but going back to the mechanisms that we have for the policy, by forbidding combustion engines. I mean, China says 2040, France will be earlier, Norway even earlier. 50% of the new cars in Norway are already electric drives. So, I mean, this is conceivable, this transformation. And then the last territory, I think when we talk about the next digital, the next telecom or digital revolution, this is essentially a vertical development. And the good news in many ways that every person in the world has a telephone. Maybe soon they'll all have a smartphones with connection to the internet. I think this is a completely new territory that we are entering. But I would say that the other side of this development is the fact that we are also threatening the very basis of our existence through these activities of the Earth system. So for example, nitrogen, as you can see, looks just like our consumption figures, like energy essentially, great acceleration. Use of land, taking land away from the nature, from the forests, into agriculture is a major issue. That's increasing still today. Tropical forest loss is increasing very exponentially as we build palm oil and other agricultural products that we need. And carbon dioxide, I think we had over the last few years a number of relatively sad records, I would argue. The concentration in the atmosphere has gone up to about 400 parts per million. I would need to update these figures. It was only 280 at the end of the Neolithic Revolution. So it's a huge increase of how much carbon we have deposited in the atmosphere. Of course, we don't have to pay for it. It doesn't cost anything to throw plastic in the ocean or the carbon in the atmosphere. And I think this is why we see this exponential growth. As a consequence of increasing amount of carbon in the atmosphere, also carbon in the ocean is increasing, and in the ocean it's an acid. And eventually the ocean takes it all up, both the heat from the atmosphere as well as the carbon. So it's a question of time. The time constant is very long, it takes a long time. But nevertheless, you can see that the increase is there. So the question is really, and this is what I would like to talk about next, the question is, given how complex these developments are, how do we know what might be happening in the future? We need some information, we need some idea where the humanity is going and how one can steer that process. So I want to spend a couple of minutes on that topic. And so again, it's a little bit stylized, but let me just argue that we have models, no matter how good or bad they are, but we do have quantitative numerical models to understand the population dynamics, you know, depending on the life expectancy, on the birth rates and so on, about economy, clearly macro models and other tools. On technology, we understand quite a lot about technological dynamics that can be modeled. And I would say, to a more limited sense, also governance, but issues like carbon tax, regulatory mechanisms, that's the core. So that you can put into model. We can put the carbon tax in the model and see what the effect is. What we cannot do, that's my argument today, is some of the deeper transformations in our society. So values and needs, power structure, and so on. For that, we don't have the numeric models. So the tools that are being used to understand where we might be going and how to possibly steer the future do not really include this explicitly. So the current development in the scientific community is to say, since we cannot model that quantitatively, let's produce narrative stories about how this might be developing and try to make it consistent with the modeling. So this is basically what I think is the current state of the art, is merging models with the scenario narratives or narratives about the future development, and hopefully that is done consistently. So for example, narrative might have an assumption that carbon tax would be introduced, and then in the model you look how high the carbon tax has to be to achieve a particular goal. The other issue that I think one has to worry about a little bit, also what I would characterize as the mega trends. For example, urbanization is exceedingly powerful. You already have more than 50% of the global population living in the cities. Toward in the second half of the century, it might be 80%. So the way I think to think about it is that the rural population will essentially stay constant, but the urban population might double over this period. So that needs to be taken care of, because on one side you can argue that, you know, urban living can be much more efficient. On the other hand, urban sprawl is certainly less efficient. So from the point of view of resources. So that's something to worry about. And if you look at the industrialized countries, most of the industrialized countries are essentially completely urbanized. This is an example of UK, and if you look at the rapidly developing countries, this is again percentage of urbanization, you can see that there is a strong catch-up and that they might be as urbanized as most industrialized countries are today in a couple of decades from now. I think the good news is that educational attainment is increasing. That's, of course, you know, the reading and writing proficiency is there. The question is there understanding proficiency? I think that's another big challenge as we think about the scenarios of future. So hopefully with secondary education, we'll be there where we are with the primary today. But tertiary, I don't even really know the statistics. That's on the order of only a couple of percent, certainly less than 10%. Tertiary attainment, and you know, if you're going in the direction of, you know, industry 4.0, the intelligent cars, intelligent industry, then I think we will need tertiary proficiency for a much larger population. That's another challenge. And maybe just a side remark, you know, the education, research development, and what we do at universities, I think it's one of the few territories of human activities where actually it's not resource limited. I mean, of course you need money for the universities, but it's not like other, it's not like material production. And that gives me hope that I think the knowledge and know-how can actually help us have the new values, a vision of the future. And so I compare that a little bit to abolishment of slavery, to be honest. You know, I think that was an incredible advancement of the humankind, that we abolished slavery, also because it was possible to do so. We had steam, we had steam engine, we had industrial production. So I hope that also modern version of the slavery will completely disappear. And the blue curve is a kind of a sign of hope. This shows the percentage of global population living in participatory form of governance. I'm adding here India. These are data from George Modelsky. I'm adding India clearly. India has a multi-party system. And you know, if this is really a sustainable trend, then I think it's also good news for the humanity. So I think there is just a backdrop in which we have to look at the scenario. So essentially, the scenarios of the future and our imagination of what needs to be done in order to transform a human society requires looking at all of these dimensions of change. And some of it, as I said before, can be modeled; others cannot be modeled, and the community usually uses the scenario. So I would like to just show you how that looks like. This is a particular example, but I think it's generic of the type of work that different scientific communities are doing. This is an example of how the current set of scenarios for the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change have been developed by the scientific communities. And I think you might be familiar with the IPCC. It was formed in 1988. It includes many scientific communities, and I think it's one of the rare institutions. It's a governmental process, but done by scientists. So scientists do the assessment, and the government adopt the assessment. So in that sense, it's a very, very, I think, unusual and singular institution where you have a combination of the governments together with the scientific community trying to understand a little bit better the climate change itself. And the way the scenarios have been done, they started with narratives, as I said, and then you have a macroeconomic model to do the GDP, for example, demographic for population, urbanization, then is also a kind of assessment and an input, and then the work is done in the sectors, and from the sectors, for example, you have the emissions. Emissions then go into a climate model or into a water model to see what the consequences would be, and then one would introduce policy measures such as a tax or a regulatory mechanism to reduce the emissions. So that's what I would like to focus on next, for the next 10 minutes or so. So if you look at this figure, it shows you the global carbon dioxide emissions. And I talked about the SAD records. 400 parts per million is the concentration in the atmosphere. By chance, we have another round number. Cumulative emissions are close to 2,000 billion tons. And every year, we emit about 40 billion tons. It goes into the air. We don't see it. It's one of the largest mass flows associated with human activity. Now, if we look into the future, in this figure, what I've done is to take all of the roughly 1,000 scenarios that are in the literature. I call this somewhat affectionately spaghetti curves. So there are two things you can think about. One is that actually we don't know anything about the future emissions. I mean, it would be one, I mean, we go to astronomic high, go all the way, you notice the red line, net negative. So you might be puzzled by that. I'll talk about this later, what that might be. So we have a huge range. So uncertainty is enormous. However, and I think this is what I hope we'll come back into the discussion. However, if you have a policy goal, if you know what you want to achieve, let's say 2 degrees, if you know what the end goal is, this huge uncertainty to a large extent disappears. The colored lines are the scenarios in the literature that achieve 2 degrees at certain likelihood. So you can see that it's, you know, much of the uncertainty, you might consider that to be a trivial point, but I don't think it is a trivial. I think it's a very important point. Once the humanity has a goal, and if we know in which direction we are going, much of this scientific uncertainty disappears, because we introduce policies and measures to bend the curve toward a low carbon future. And so that's how the scenarios look like. And in fact, the current set of scenarios, this is again carbon dioxide emissions globally. There are 4 sets that have been developed by the scientific community that were used in the last assessment report of the IPCC and will be used in the next one, the AR6, that's being just right now, it's on the drawing board, how it might look like. And the lower one, the blue one, is consistent with 2 degrees, and you can see variations around it. And the top one is bad news. Top one is continuation of the carbon-intensive world. So what I would like to do, yeah, please.
If you're taking questions, have you done studies on the impact in the environment and the add to the CO2 contamination by way of the genetically modified soy that has a molecule of
thank you. In the GMO soy, of which 96% of soy grown in the United States is genetically modified, in the compound is formaldehyde. So when you look at the formaldehyde molecule, it has carbon in it. So the breaking of the bonds in the environment, perhaps, and I'm figuring is a contributor to the CO2 pollution. So in part because genetically modified soy and the other genetically engineered crops are legitimized to be produced agriculturally in the US as well as somewhat around the world, but there's very strong constraints in the EU against GMO growth.
Yeah.
But My question is, so what research do you have, or studies, or do you have scientists that you can trust to do some form of modeling to determine when the formaldehyde breaks down in the environment, what the contribution or the add to the CO2, and so you can get a better estimate or guesstimate on what future CO2 risks are going to be, because unless and until they get rid of GMO soy, and that's pretty prolific, and then I don't know about the corn, so the corn's used for the ethanol. So there's a lot of contamination that's a factor by companies like Monsanto, which parade themselves as being sustainable, so.
Well, thank you for that comment. You know, I cannot directly react to it. Maybe we'll come back into the discussion, because otherwise I think I'll divert from my lecture. But let me just say, as you pointed out, that in Europe, particularly in Austria, where I live, there's a huge resistance against genetically modified agriculture. On the other hand, as you also know, there is a community out there that believes that we will save some land through genetic modification. So it's a very controversial. I would argue that there are, you know, three in the carbon business. So let me just respond that way. There are three really controversial issues, in my view, mostly controversial within the scientific community and in general among the stakeholders. One is nuclear. What is the role of nuclear? Another one is whether we will have carbon and capture in the future. Very, very controversial. And I would consider that to be the third one, how the land is being used for, in particular, for agriculture. But maybe we'll return to that later. Let me just try to go through the rest of the talk so that we have some time for the discussion. What I would like to show you now is a film. And the film will be of the lower and the upper scenario. The one that's 2 degrees and one that's well above 5 degrees. So please just watch it. Maybe I'll skip that. So let's go to the film. So you can see on top is the high emission scenario, on the low is the low emission scenario. We are back in 1970, so this is still the history. This is done with the high resolution Japanese model. But as we go into the future, please look at it, and you can see the temperature scale on the horizontal. You know, orange is already bad news. White is really, really bad news. So now we are coming to the present day, so please watch the difference between the two. You can see that the North Pole is warming up much faster, twice as fast as the world. But the difference between the two scenarios in 2040 is not that large. They start diverging only after 2040. And if you remember how big the difference is in the emissions, now we are in the 60s, so the top world is really glowing, very, very warm in particular. There'll be not that much of the polar ice left. Greenland will be also threatened. Below, it doesn't look very nice, but certainly it's much, much, much easier to understand how we might be actually dealing with this kind of future. So as I said, the lower scenario is 2 degrees, the top scenario is on the order of 5 to 6 degrees. This is if we combust much of the fossils that is available to the humanity. So I would say also from the policy and regulatory mechanism point of view, this explains, I think, a little bit of our dilemma that we have. The dilemma is really huge, because we have to act now, but the benefits will be immediate, but the huge benefits between a world that might be catastrophic and the world that is a little bit more acceptable will really come in decades from now. So we're talking about the intergenerational equity here. So I think that is important. Now let me show you how the lower scenario looks as a history of humanity and in the future. So the lower scenario shows you essentially how the world industrialized. This is the carbon emissions per unit area. So UK, the Stockton-Darlington Railway, now as you can see, US is industrializing. We are 1900s, where coal is the king around the world, moving through the First World War, now over the Second World War, when oil becomes dominant. So oil paradigm, and you can see that emissions are spreading throughout the world. Now we are in the 70s, going to the present time, and the world is essentially depending on fossil. 80% of the energy is fossil energy in the world. And now as we go into the future, that's the lower scenario. It's radically decarbonizing, absolutely radically decarbonizing. The emissions are, you can see, going down, and all of a sudden there is green area. And that's what I wanted to spend a few more minutes before I conclude on. What does this all mean? So you can see this is a radically different future than we are today. The green areas, even if they might be in the wrong places, denote where we need to have deeply negative emissions. And one possible way of doing negative emissions is to return the land to nature through afforestation. Another one is a technical one that has to do with doing hopefully sustainable biomass and removing carbon from the biomass and storing it underground. So that would be net negative emission because that would work like a pump from the atmosphere. And you know, there are other technologies for removing it directly from the atmosphere, but that would be quite expensive from the current perspective. So the future emissions would look something like that. The green area are the 2-degree scenarios. These are the 1.5-degree scenarios, and the second set are 1.5-degree scenarios if you have further delays, for example, U.S. leaving the Paris Agreement that might postpone the really deep reduction. So you can see that in these futures how much net negative emissions are. So I think this is really our challenge and the reason to act relatively quickly. And the logic of that can be explained very, very quickly here without going into the details. On the horizontal scale, you have the cumulative emissions of the human civilization, how much we have emitted up to now from the beginning. Vertically is the temperature. So if you just read the top scale, to stabilize at 2 degrees, it's almost a linear relationship. We cannot emit our carbon, global carbon endowment for the whole humanity is about 3,000 billion tons. But I said before, we emitted already 2,000, and a few years have passed ever since. So we have about 800 left to emit. And for 2 degrees, it'll be significantly less, maybe 250 billion tons. So we're still emitting 40 billion tons every year. So I think this is, so to say, relatively robust, what I'm saying, that the time might be not on our side, that we don't have enough time to restructure the economy in the right direction. As an example, and I will not go into the details, there are studies that indicate, for example, to urbanize, have 80% of the global population living in the cities, you need to produce cement, you need to produce steel. That results in the carbon emissions with the current technologies. We can, in theory, do steel carbon-free, for example, reducing it by hydrogen. I will not get into those details, but the point is, if our total budget, remaining budget for 2 degrees is 800, and for 1.5 degrees, about 250, building cities with the current technologies would already result in 350 for the rest of the world. So there's nothing left for anything else. So this shows how deep the transformation must be, and you know, that I'm not telling you kind of a biased story. I would like to illustrate here on the horizontal scale are the emissions in the 2100 from the models again. And if you look to the right, they're negative emissions. That means we are removing carbon from the atmosphere. So for the range of temperature between 1.5 degrees, between the two yellow bars, go up to about 2.7. In that range of the, you can see that the majority of scenarios relies on these net negative emissions. And some are on the far left on your side. That means they have maybe 40 billion tons negative emissions. That's the same as our positive emissions today. So that indicates, I think, again, this problem of the timing and the dynamics, that if we don't reduce in time, we might have to have this kind of a backstop option that from the current point of view might not be sustainable. We don't know. We don't know whether we can do that sustainably. I know because I come from the energy area that more than 100 exajoules of biomass can be already questioned as not being sustainable. And we conducted with the about 500 authors around the world, what we call global energy assessment, very similar to IPCC in the energy area. So let me just show you how that looks like. Now, what I would like to show you, this is the history of energy, how the energy system might need to look like to be consistent with these goals. Eliminating air pollution, connecting the 3 billion people who cook with traditional biomass, 1.3 billion people who do not have the electricity, and achieving 2 degrees and a number of other sustainable goals. So as I said before, we are 80% fossil. And if you look at the future, the biggest option is what you can see up there in the gray area is efficiency improvements. And that's change of our lifestyle, how do we drive, what kind of houses we have, and so on. The rest would be structural change in the energy system. As you can see, fossils will even, by the time frame of 2030, which is the Agenda 2030, the Sustainable Development Goals, even by that time, that will be significantly reduced, the fossils, but there will be lots of carbon capture and storage, and in some part of the world, like where I live, is rather unacceptable. So I have another 5 minutes. Let me just try to illustrate it to you. So this kind of massive carbon capture and storage would have also problems from the water point of view. This is why an integrated point of view is required. We have to look at all of the nexus areas. However, there are other scenarios that might be better for water. And there are even radical futures like this one that has no carbon capture and storage. But look how big the transformation here would be. That means all of us in 20 years from now will be driving, or even 13 years from now, will be driving electric cars, might not even own cars, might have the, you know, intelligent cars that drive themselves, and so on. So I think one has to have this multiple perspective. This would be a glimpse into it, how it might look like. On the vertical scale, you have the global economic output. Let's say it's 80 trillion now, roughly. It shows you the percentage of global economic output that you would need to devote to three important energy goals. One is improving energy security. That's clear. That's important for all of us. Eliminating air pollution. You can see it's about 0.5%, let's say about 500 billion. And climate, this is a good order of magnitude, about 1 trillion. There's uncertainty, but this is a good number for orientation. And our analysis indicates that if you could do all three of them at the same time, that one would have significant synergies, that the total bill would be about 40% lower. And I think this is very important as you think about the future investments. So that's in the energy. And this kind of thinking went into the three science-based goals of the Sustainable Development Goals. That's SDG 7 of the 17 goals that have been negotiated here in New York 2 years ago in 2015. So we will need other Sustainable Development Goals that have equally important scientific base in order to be able to understand how the transformation to a sustainable future would be. I hope that you're all familiar with this, with all of the 17 goals. My point is there are trade-offs among them, there is no doubt, but the focus needs to be on the synergies, in particular also from the investment point of view. I will skip this one. So we have initiated an activity called the World in 2050, that we have about 60 scientific organizations around the world trying to understand how we could achieve all of the 17 goals synergetically. That's our objective, and the decarbonization is a central part of that, going to low carbon society. So we will be looking at 2030 and then 2050 and beyond, because the world doesn't stop in 2030. And the way to imagine it, let me just skip this one, go straight to this one. The way to imagine that is that we have the 17 sustainable goal, and that's a symbol, a kind of a bullseye there. And in the long run, we need to make sure that the humanity somehow ends up in a safe and just place for humanity and the planet system, symbolized here by planetary boundaries. And the idea would be then to scenarios that I've shown you only on carbon, the idea would be to develop scenarios that actually achieve all of the 17 goals by 2030 and sustainable future beyond. So that's our objective right now. And hopefully there will be a number of pathways that would lead us there so that we do have some degrees of freedom, but the carbon and the carbon policy needs to be central to all. So we'll conclude in a few minutes. Let me just show you that this transformation is not the first one. This is again stylized, but think in terms of periods of 50 years for a number of sectors, railways, flying machines, telecommunication, individual mobility, and industrial production. There is no doubt that these are connected, but that they have also fundamentally changed in the periods of about 50 years or so. And I venture to give some pictures for the 2050. This is just for illustrative purposes. Nobody knows what the future will bring, of course. But the point is that that I'm trying to make is that by 2050, it's conceivable that we would have a fundamentally different world. But we don't have the time until 2050. So I think many might ask, well, great, but even if we have this transformation, it might be too late. Well, let me show you an example from this city here. It's one of my favorite photographs. Mm-hmm. On the left, you have Easter Parade 1900, and on the right, Easter Parade 1913. Mm-hmm. And the reason why I like it, that's exactly how much time we have to 2030. So you can see that in an urban area, we did have the examples of a fundamental transformation. So maybe we will have electric mobility if we have the right instruments in place already in 13 years from now. It takes about 30 years to replace the whole vehicle fleet. And by the way, just one comment, since I'm running out of time, I'll make only one comment. One thing that we did lose by switching away from horses, the intelligence. Horses knew how to go home. Cars don't. So hopefully electric cars will learn that great capacity. So we'll need many new technologies. Let me just show you some of the radical ideas that are around. But these will technologies will not come as manna from heaven. We have to invest in order to have them. So that will be the concluding part of my talk. Some of the improvements will come through the scale-up. So some of the technologies will be radical. Others will be through a major scale-up. So wind power plants might be 300-400 meters tall in the future because you have large economies of scale. There are also some good news from Texas. Let me say, there is a power plant, 50 megawatts, natural gas that runs with a CO2 turbine running with CO2 as a working fluid. So the output of the power plant is highly concentrated CO2 at the right pressure to inject underground. So this could be a way of doing zero emission fossils, at least in the meantime. But I realize that that's a, in many communities, controversial issue because that we might continue our lock-in into the fossil energy if we go that way. And then I think this is quite important. This is, I'm coming to the end. Learning curves, the so-called experience curves. That is the solution, I think, to our problem. Behavior, lifestyle, and improvement of technology and institutions, institutional arrangements. You see here, this is the vertical scale is the unit cost of photovoltaic cell. And on the horizontal scale is the installed capacity of the photovoltaic cell. We did this about 20 years ago. And if you projected this curve into the future, you could sort of read how much we would have to invest in order to buy ourselves down this curve. And curiously enough, if I show you the current curve, that's exactly what happened. Let me just show it to you. So that's exactly the same angle as the curve before. The yellow line is the improvement of the cost of the photovoltaics. And today in the world, we have about 230 gigawatts installed. And the costs have gone down two orders of magnitude. So if we continue down there, in this direction, photovoltaics and other renewable technologies might be the solution for the future. But for that, we need sustainable investments. And I think this is the key in the new direction. I'll skip this since I have only 1 minute, but this is the last slide. So let me just say a few words about the investments. And I'll now only focus on energy, but I think the picture is generic. So this is how much we invest roughly today in energy between 2005 and 2010. Average was 1 trillion worldwide. Today is about 1.6 trillion. These things go up. Now, a future with no sustainability policies. If you continue the way we are doing it today, as you can see, there would be significant investments in the fossils, and the total volume would be about 2.5 trillion that one would have to invest. So it's a significant increase over what we invest today. But look at one of those sustainable futures I was talking about. The bill is not that much higher. So I think that the story that the investments into the sustainable future are costlier is not necessarily correct. The investment would be in a fundamentally different direction, would be in the efficiency, away from fossils, in order to buy ourselves down these learning curves. So I think this is our challenge. You know, today, subsidies for fossil energy are about 500 billion around the world. So if you add that to the current investment, there would be even the financial flows that would be required. But the direction has to be changed. And what's really different here, maybe that's the last remark I would like to make, what's really different here, if you think of that photovoltaic curve, think about the photovoltaics. The main investment is actually to build them and put them in place. Once they're there, they have almost zero marginal cost. And that is true for many of these technologies, that we have lots of upfront investments, but relatively low costs in the long run. But the question is how to make that attractive to the marketplace. So that's the last slide. This is a vision of the future. On the days when the Stockton-Darlington Railway was built, this Mr. Palmer had a great vision of a sustainable railway with sails, but you know, he was not stupid. He actually had horses that you could lower down when there was no wind. And you know, his vision was, you know, right and not right. We already have huge infrastructure, but interesting enough, he actually became a millionaire because he built monorails. He was the first one to build steam monorails. So thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much for this very, very extensive discussion of the challenge we can face now. And we thought that Paulo would make some comments now from his perspective. We are in a different environment than all engineers or economists here, so please let us know what you
think.
We take questions after this.
It's very difficult to follow this presentation and try to keep your attention, and particularly following an economist, lawyers are going to have a hard time keeping the attention up. But first of all, let me thank you, the organizers, for giving me the chance to say a few words about the legal framework to address climate change. And I also wanted to thank my colleague, Martin Gelter, that really brought this event to Fordham. Now, a few words about the legal framework that is trying to address climate change at the global level. First of all, what I heard about from Naki was time. We don't have time. And when we look at the international regulatory framework, I can see that there is a positive trajectory in the sense that the international community seems to have picked up the speed in terms of addressing climate change, adopting regulation to deal with climate change. And think about the three landmark agreements that we had to regulate climate change at the global level. The Climate Change Convention was adopted in 1992. And enter into force almost immediately. It took 5 more years, 1997, to get the Kyoto Protocol, and it took 8 years for the Kyoto Protocol to enter into force. From 1997, we had to wait until 2015 for the international community, after many attempts, to finally reach a global agreement to try to address climate change. But when the Paris Agreement was adopted in 2015, it only took 1 year, actually less than 1 year, for a sufficient number of states to ratify the agreement and for the agreement to come into existence in 2016. So I think that the first point that I wanted to make is that although international works sometimes at a very slow pace, a pace that may not be ideal for addressing challenges and problems that need immediate attention, it seems that at least when it comes to the climate regime, there is a new sense of urgency that the international community is recognizing that we need to move faster than we are commonly used to. Secondly, I think the very important thing about the climate agreement and the Paris Agreement is that it exists. I think it's not perfect, it has its critics, it has its shortcomings, it's a compromise. At the end of the day, in Paris, the main goal was to get everybody on board. You wanted every nation on the planet to sign up to this deal, fundamentally to say, we are all committed to doing something about climate change. And as little as that may sound, at the global level, that actually is quite a lot. The main agreement was to have an agreement, to have a commitment to do something about climate change. And I think Paris, at a minimum, does that. The elements of the climate change and the Paris Agreement, if we want, we can talk about what the key provisions are, but essentially the Paris Agreement is a bottom-up treaty. It's not a top-down treaty. It really delegates to the states, to nation states, the adoption of measures to address climate change. I think many recognize that the Kyoto Protocol was too much top-down, that it prescribed the same measures for everybody, and therefore made it very difficult for a lot of countries to meet the obligation of the Kyoto Protocol. Paris tried to avoid that by essentially saying, these are the goals, these are the goals that we need to meet, this is the ambitions that we have, you tell us what your contribution is, you tell us, country X, how best it is for you to achieve these goals. So I think that is, again, a particularly interesting innovation from a legal point of view to allow countries to tell the international community what it is that they're trying to do. I think the third important feature of the current regime is that we probably wouldn't have this conversation if we didn't have an international legal framework. I think the international legal framework whatever is weak or strong, and sometimes it's not as strong as I wish it would be, at a minimum, it tells everybody that this is where we're going. This is where the world is going. And I would say the climate change agreement and the Paris Agreement is more than anything an economic agreement rather than an environmental agreement. I think it really is the most important agreement that tells us where the planet is going. And whether you're a business leader, a member of civil society, an individual, an NGO, you need to look at this treaty because it tells us what you just told us, that 2050 is not going to look like 2000. We may not know what it's going to look like, but at a minimum, the Paris Agreement tells us that everybody will have to start taking strong action towards a different economy, towards a different way of regulating and doing business. And I think that's a very important symbol. Another point that I wanted to make is the despair about the abandonment of the Paris Agreement by the current administration. For those of us that have been around, this is not the first time we despair about the US and climate change. We despaired for quite a few years when the US abandoned the Kyoto Protocol. If you remember, there was a time where the administration and the time, the G.W. Bush administration, decided to not go through with the previous administration on Kyoto. And we survived. The international community survived, and we actually continued to move along without the leadership of the United States, which was sad, which I think is still is sad, but we continued. But I would also like to add that, interestingly, in some ways, I think the abandonment of the Paris Agreement by the Trump administration gave more publicity to this agreement than it ever received. I think there's nobody on this planet that has not heard about Paris, that doesn't know what Paris says, that is now all of a sudden committed to do what Paris does. And I would say the United States is a very complex country. What has happened is that the federal government has given up its leadership on climate change. But there is so much happening at the state level, at the local level, among NGOs, among grassroots activists, amongst American citizens. There are states that, frankly, if they were not part of the federation, would be some of the largest economies in the world. California, New York, they are leading the way when it comes to action on climate change. There are cities, like New York City, that is a very ambitious program when it comes to climate change. There are companies, Ford, GM, and others that are really looking at the new economy that you were describing, very much because of the international legal framework that tells us we're moving to a different economy, where essentially carbon-free is going to be the rule, and everybody's coming on board. So what I would say, the fact that the US has abandoned the Paris Agreement is not the end of the US broader participation. There is still a lot going on at the state level, there is still a lot going on at the local level, and I think many American citizens, a great majority of American citizens, feel that climate change is a concern that needs to be addressed. Finally, what I wanted to say, what is the role of law in bringing us to the next economy, to the next revolution? I think it's a very difficult, challenging question to ask, but I would argue the law has a role to play. At a minimum, one of the things that Naki said earlier is that it provides certainty, it provides a direction where we are going. And I think the changes that we're going to try to achieve, I don't think are going to come in isolation, where you're going to have economists working on something, politicians on something else, and lawyers in another room doing their own thing. I think that this is exactly the kind of problem that requires all of us working together. And I really do think events like these that bring together people that speak different languages, but they work for a common goal, illustrate that law has to be part of the conversation, at a minimum to set a trajectory, to set rules to where we're going. And I hope that on this note, we can have further questions later on, but thank you very much for your presentation. I'm even more motivated to work in this field now. Thank you.
Of a different perspective, but it's... Now, I think we can start now the question and answer period. Maybe short questions.
There's a tendency, of course, because one has a theory and experience and active or kind of roots, do long talk. So, but please be precise and short in your questions. Yeah. Would you allow three questions and another? Okay, let's have three questions. One, two, three. Yeah. Oh, there's a.
I have one.
Yeah. Wait. We keep going several rounds. Yeah. Okay.
I have the microphone, so I'm obviously first.
Yes. Okay.
Two short questions. One. It's a fantastic presentation, Dr. Stanich, and I hope that this is available. Some of these slides are available online from your institute, is that so? And two, you talked about efficiency being a significant part, next to last slide, of where we should be going. But I have another concept also, and that is lifestyle. How much do we need in our own lives, in this culture, in the first world especially, for things like the extreme air conditioning in this room? And my wife left early, she couldn't deal with it anymore, she went home.
My name is Marty Rowell, and I'm with the Henry George School of Social Science. And I wanted to comment on a couple of slides. Mm-hmm. One is the problematic nature of mapping out GDP when globally, especially in advanced nations, GDP is tied in with speculation of land and residential development. So there's a lost land rent that could go to pay for some of this. And the other thing was the problem with the carbon tax, because actually there's two things involved in the use of fossil fuels. First is the resource that's being extracted, but then the burning of the fuel. So the extraction and the burning is actually two resource rents that are available for capture if you wanted to put a taxing system together. And I think that might answer the question, where does the money come from? Well, we take it from the monopolists that are taking the value out of society.
One other question in the back there.
Thank you very much. Want to say Naki, okay to do that. I'm Kevin Coley, I'm with the Christian Brothers, and I'm the director of the Thomas Ferry Forum for Ecological Dialogue at Iona College. A question about a book that just came out recently. Paul Hawken has put together with his group 100 best ideas for what he calls drawdown. In a sense, they're pushing aside from the questions of regulations and the rest of it. They're saying, here are 100 ways we can do the drawdown of carbon. I wonder if you've heard about it, and maybe you could comment about it in light of what we're talking about.
Yeah, I know you. Whatever.
Thank you very much for all of this question. Now, first of all, the slides, as far as I'm concerned, of course, the slides can be posted, and you have my email if you have any particular questions or so. I'll be happy to try to respond to that. The second part of that is the issue of the efficiency and lifestyle. So in some ways, I mean, you could argue that they actually go hand in hand. They're not completely independent. I would argue they're not completely independent territories of human behavior, because to be efficient also requires to change your lifestyle. I would say that the scenarios that I've shown, let's say the 2-degree scenario and so on, not only requires technological change, it's not only technical fixes, it's actually human behavior and regulation, what you talked about. And I think there needs to be a synergy between these three domains. And I have no doubt that high efficiency technologies, I know many studies that indicate high efficiency of technologies can be completely wrecked through the wrong type of lifestyle. Think of a zero energy or plus energy house, a house that doesn't need any energy from outside. It's self-sufficient. If you leave the windows open in the winter, the strategy will not work. I mean, it's a trivial example, but that would be my point. I think we need both. And switching to electric mobility is one of my favorite topics because it's so much connected to lifestyle. You know, if you read car magazines or whatever, technical books, they will say that electric cars don't perform like combustion engine cars. That's true. But I mean, you know, also horses did not perform the same way as the early automobiles. It's a completely different world that we're entering. And I would also argue we need the right legal frameworks for that. But we also need orientation. That's what I appreciated from your comments. I fully agree with that. We need a vision and we need a goal. And I think, and new values. And that will require lifestyle changes and not just technology. The third question, I've heard about the book, but I have to admit I have not looked at it. I think 100 best ideas. I've also seen a large portfolio of best ideas. I don't think that's lacking. I think the ideas are here. I would even argue that we know how to do it. But we still don't have that vision, exactly what you're talking, you know. I mean, Paris might be the beginning of it and the Sustainable Development Goal, but we don't have it because having ideas, I would say, you know, from the economic point of view of technology, idea is an invention. It's something new, but we need to go beyond that. We need innovations that are actually deployed and investment to have those learning effects that I was talking about. So I think the key will be how to create the markets. And I would argue, just like photovoltaics, that the markets don't exist in vacuum. I mean, they need legal frameworks. They're constructed by our society. And if you have a market for carbon, that was part of your question, then clearly that will be a strong signal to move away. So I'm fully behind the idea that I think don'ts need to be taxed and wants should not be taxed. I mean, a radical thing would be to say, you know, reduce the income tax and increase the taxes on the resources, for example. But I realize that's easier said than done. But I think some value of carbon is absolutely necessary. The challenge, the little I know about how one might actually do the mechanisms, the challenge is that the taxes, at least in the models, whatever it's worth, are humongously high to achieve the type of transformation I'm talking about. That would start with, let's say, not $10 per ton, that would start with $1,500 and would be going monolithically up in the region of a couple of hundred to $1,000 over the end of the century. So I think we need more than just a carbon tax. I think carbon tax would be, it is an important tool, but I think we also need this kind of legal and regulatory mechanisms to nudge us in the right direction.
Some other aspects that you want to...
What I would say is that I think, as I was saying earlier, I think there is no one magic solution to the problem. I think it requires a lot of different tools that are brought to the table. And also, from an international point of view, I do a lot of work in the developing world. The conversation in the developing world very often, it is as much as on climate change, but it is as often more on development, on promoting development. So whilst we're talking about some of these issues, I was thinking about some of the pictures that you showed, particularly the two families, the amount of food that each family had at its disposal for a week. The truth is that there are many people like that refugee family that looks at the picture of the German family and wants that, and wants to get that, and aspires to that particular economic model, which the planet cannot cope with. And of course, governments respond to those demands and respond to those needs, when the opposite is probably what we're supposed to be doing. And I think, again, law plays a role, but education plays another important role. You were talking about values changes. There's a lot of conversation that we need to have about what we need and what we truly want and what we can have. And I think it requires a conversation about the society that we want to live in. What I'm encouraged by is that those conversations are increasingly beginning to take place. And what is interesting, at the corporate level as well, I think a critical role to address climate change will have to be played by corporations to come up with innovation, with the ideas that you're talking about and the means to implement them, to put pressure on politicians across the world to actually make some of the technology that we have available is expensive, more affordable so that more people will buy into. Because one of the big challenges that the truth is that many people aspire to more rather than less, and that's another big challenge when it comes to climate change, I think.
I really appreciate your comment. Let me just say, I think one of the notions that's out there, and a number of colleagues from the developing countries, I think, are committed to, is the notion of leapfrogging. That they will actually maybe not aspire to that picture of the food for the week. I think today even one can talk about vegetarian diet. I mean, it's changing. I mean, you might be aware of that in Germany even. You know, where after the war, the idea was to have a pork chop as a symbol of affluence. I mean, young generation is increasingly becoming vegetarian. This is on the table when we talk about the lifestyle changes, because the vegetarian diet has significantly lower footprint. There's no doubt about it that we will not need the type of agriculture we have today if we would shift. But it's, again, lifestyle change. It's not. It requires completely new values.
So we have second round, one, two, choice. We take three women now. you're first, oh, I overworked. Well, why don't you? Microphone
already. You need not these administrative powers.
Yes, I have to be more strict than four. Well, go ahead, yeah.
Okay.
We'll do another round then. But please be short.
Yeah, I'll be short.
Give the other girl.
Promise. I was wondering if you could comment on the forces that are actually right now fighting climate change in all what you are. I mean, are these the usual suspect, coal corporations, fossil fuel, I don't know where they are, you know, their official position versus their actual action, and lastly, countries like Saudi Arabia, I don't know where Russia is, I mean, and what is their rationale?
Short on profit. Thank you. I'm curious. There's a tremendous amount of productive and positive focus on climate change and focus on temperature. Primarily, and I think it's been really pulled people together. But there are a couple of other dimensions, many other dimensions, water quality, biodiversity, that really maybe is important to ending up with a world where we can all survive sustainably. And I wonder if you see that those dimensions increasingly becoming part of your research and, you know, consensus.
Thank you. If I remember my undergraduate economics, one of the phrases about the dynamic of capitalism was this idea of creative disruption.
Yeah.
And everyone is sitting here today with an example of 21st century creative disruption and the electronics revolution and the internet revolution and the smartphone revolution. I'm wondering what we can harness from those dynamics of creative disruption to destroy the carbon-based economy and help quickly advance a decarbonized economy.
Just one additional remark concerning this. I think this speaks about some kind of, well, if you destroy something, you destroy also jobs. You destroy industries. You destroy firms. In other words, we have some losers, and we may have some gain, people who gain with the new iPhones, with renewable energy, with other things. So the question comes up, so to speak, of somewhat of equity, and do the winners compensate somewhat the losers in some sense. And this was not resolved in the creative destruction of Schumpeter. He said, well, justice is capitalist dynamic. So, but there are a lot of losers, a lot of people gain. So this is another important question. If we move to this new paradigm to carbon-free economy, what will be the distribution of the effects? Oh, yeah, that's fine. Okay.
Do you want to go first, or shall we?
Well, you're an economist, so this is all yours.
Yeah, I would characterize myself as a non-practicing economist.
a non-economist altogether.
I work in the disciplinary area for so many times, I no longer know what I have expertise on. But But I think it goes to some of your Paolo comments before this first question, you know, who is opposing it? Of course, there are many oppositions. But even since you mentioned Saudi Arabia, even in Saudi Arabia, there are other streams. You know, Saudi Arabia is also investing in the renewable energy. And if you have seen some of the recent publications in the warming of the types of scenario that I showed, you know, Saudi Arabia would be unlivable in the natural environment. Our body can only take that much. I think we go, if you go above, well above 45, 50 degrees, it's impossible to survive in the long run. So I think as you said, I think there are strong streams. I think even Trump's opposition is producing counter-opposition. I think the world has really changed, at least I would argue that, since the Kyoto Protocol went into force exactly 20 years ago by the way in December. So I think we have so many currents, even in the countries that are traditionally against it. Let me give you another example. Astana hosted the World Expo on future energy over the last 4 months. It was just closed on 10th of December. Now, Astana has uranium, more than you want coal, oil and gas. I mean, they have fossils to oblivion, but they also have wind and solar. And there are also streams and counter streams, even in that country. I mean, the people who are sitting on the fossil resources are saying, let's sell them while we can still get the value. Why are you building windmills? The others are saying, we'll be left behind if you stay in the fossil age, just like we didn't want to stay in the Stone Age. So I would say, you know, the world is dynamic, but opposition, I would say, is becoming thinner and thinner, in my view. And I'm just repeating what you're saying. I think in this country in particular, I think we have so many private sectors, NGOs, even states, that will be contributing toward the post-Paris world. So I would say the opposition is there, clearly. I think the coal might be the biggest enemy of the transformation, because coal will be very difficult, I think, to adjust with carbon capture and storage. I think gas can be still there for a while because it's the cleanest, or at least from the emissions point of view. But I would strongly argue that the opposition is becoming thinner. You know, the current government in Washington, I think, is being in a very small minority. And I would even imagine that, you know, the Chinese commitment might be a counter-reaction to that. Maybe they see an opportunity to become the world leader in the decarbonization. Let me just say, in case you have not followed that, during the last few years, carbon emissions worldwide have not increased. It's incredible. It's really incredible. They have not increased. So hopefully it will be ramping down very soon. So that would be that. Oh, the temperature is a proxy. That's, I really think, a good question. So in some sense, you know, it is what we would like to have in other areas, at least I would like to have such a symbolic number for ecosystems, you know, biodiversity, in many other areas. We don't have it. Climate is one of the few things where we actually have that agreement, that 2 degrees or 1.5 is a nice compromise. But of course, we all understand, I think, that this, you know, temperature is not the best indicator. I think that's what you were alluding to. And it shouldn't be the only one. So I think there is a big movement. I just come from the meeting where people have been discussing, you know, WRI and GF and some other organizations, that we need to work, or rather that scientific community needs to produce science-based indicators for many of those things. So in climate, I think we have them. We have a larger portfolio, but we don't have it in the other areas. So I think that is a challenge ahead of us, to produce something that I think that those people who are actually in action can employ for changing the policy and catalyzing the big change. And then the question that I really like a lot, to be honest, the creative destruction from Schumpeter, the gales of creative destruction, actually, Schumpeter was talking. I had a slide on it, but I figured I will not have time to go to it. This is really, so to say, my home in some ways. I really think that this next revolution is a creative destruction. As you say, I think there will be losers and winners, but I actually believe in the long run there will be more winners. I think it's, from the employment point of view, a great opportunity. Where I have the worry is right now, since it's a creative destruction, that means there will be stranded capital. How do we resolve that? I really don't know how that will be done, because, you know, you can imagine, we didn't want the banks to go under, we don't want German car industry to go under even after the Dieselgate. And so the question is, you know, are we going to be subsidizing those, the standard capital, so it survives and prolongs the, you know, the current state rather than accelerate? So that's where I would see the paradox, you know, what we will end up doing, whether we'll maintain the old or actually, you know, promote and incentivize the new.
Just very quick, because I think it's more important to hear.
Yeah, okay, there are some questions in the back here. Yeah. Oh, so many. First there was a lady in the back, first it was about 15 minutes ago, or and then you.
Hi, this is Pam. The explanation that the Trump administration gave, in March or April, as they were pulling out, was that China and India are the greatest polluters. In fact, if, you know, it wouldn't really count for much if the U.S. pulled out, because they're the ones who have to get their act in order. Do you actually believe in that statement? That was the statement that was provided by the Trump administration at the time they were pulling out. My second question concerns the your emphasis on the cars, when in fact the large majority of the carbon emissions emitted are from the planes and transportation vehicles like the ships and all that. And what do you propose, that what do we do to slow down the use of, you know, flights, overseas flights, and shipments that, you know, go over oceans? And every time we order things from China, for instance, that involves large shipments. So I think for any drive, I mean, what do you propose? How do we, you know, on one hand, we want free trade. On the other hand, free trade comes with a cost that damages the environment, because all those things that we get from China have to come with a ship.
Sure.
Okay, that's okay.
Yes.
Thank you. I have two questions dealing with money and law.
So the first one,
The first one is that the whole economic system of the world is based on faith. So money is not a problem. We can just print it. I mean, Congress just upped the debt ceiling, right? And Goldman Sachs guy said, you know, Bitcoin is a farce, right? So the money is there when you need it. Secondly, from the law point of view, there was a talk on the radio a couple of days ago about impeachment, and that impeachment in the definition of misdemeanors and, you know, wrongs can be fit to other things than we think about in terms of, you know, the idea of pulling out of the Paris Accords, some people think, is an impeachable offense because it's doing harm to the American people. So what is your reaction to that?
I can't believe the
decision.
Thank
you.
Like,
we have
to
say, well, why don't we go? But I'll be short. This will be really short. Again, going back to next round.
Regarding urbanization in the slide, if you tried to de-urbanize, I don't think there would be enough land to sustain the existing population.
Okay.
I know I didn't frame it as a question, but there must be a question in there.
Well, let me start and just, you know, there's been a lot of issues raised, and I think I agree with Naki when it comes to the climate deniers and their power. I think it's there, but it's diminishing to the point of becoming increasingly relevant. I would say, in terms of the trade issue, I think one solution is at the moment, environmental costs are not considered, not internalized in the price of what we pay. One possibility would be to internalize those costs. So you're free to travel, you're free to do whatever it is that you want to do, but you're gonna have to pay for it. So if you want to order something that is produced in China, it may cost you more than something that is produced here, because we're gonna have to pay for the carbon that is used in producing, transporting, and delivering that to you. Of course, the political dimensions of that and the cost are huge, but these are issues that are being addressed in terms of paying for the environmental cost that you pay to atmosphere, water, and so on and so forth. In terms of the US withdrawal, I think there are many reasons why the Trump administration decided to withdraw from the Paris Agreement. One was that, yes, that for a long time there was this argument that developing countries didn't have any obligation to do anything under the climate agreements. That reason and that justification is no longer there because they've actually agreed in Paris to do their part. And therefore, that particular argument, I don't think, stands up to scrutiny as, frankly, much else when it comes to this particular administration. In terms of the impeachment for withdrawing for, I don't think there is any constitutional ground for that. I mean, I'm not a constitutional scholar, but I would say that's really very, very, very far-fetched. I think it could be a political argument. I think from a legal point of view, I don't really see anybody taking this any further. And then finally, I think the question of urbanization, I think that is another critical issue. We're seeing more and more people moving towards city, moving toward urbanized areas. We are seeing megalopolis growing in the developing world for all sorts of reasons. And attempt to fight the movement to urban areas has really failed virtually everywhere that has been tried. And figuring out a way to bring intelligent cities. I'm doing a project with a group of scientists trying to figure out how to make intelligent, environmental friendly city, to try to reconcile the need for development versus the need to be more environmental friendly. And I really think, to sum it up, that that really is the challenge, the sustainable development challenge. I think it's very difficult to tell people, and sometimes environmentalists speak this gloom and doom language that really is unattractive to a lot of people. Many people really don't want to leave without doing certain things. And if you tell them that in 2050, this is what the world is going to look like, and therefore you have to make sacrifices today, it's going to be very politically difficult to achieve. It's like pension. You know, we all know we need to save a lot of money for when we retire, but unless we are forced to, we are not going to do that. So we need to find, to me, a better language. And I really see climate change more as an opportunity. We can figure out a way to live differently, to do some of the things that we do without doing it the way that we do. There are different energy sources. It doesn't have to be fossil fuel. For instance, I do a lot of work in sub-Saharan Africa, and I'm appalled sometimes by the fact that solar energy should basically power the entire continent. It doesn't make any sense that in a continent rich in natural resources like the sun, you build fossil fuel plants in 2017. And all of that is for political reasons. Not for scientific reasons, not because we don't have the technology, it's because of the mindset and because of the politics that need to change. So that to me is really the challenge that Paris is posing to us. We need to move to a different economy that is powered differently, but it's going to be very difficult and politically, frankly, unachievable to basically tell people, these are all the hundreds of things that you can do, those that are already doing those things. And on top of them, telling the 2 billion people that don't have all of these that we have today to say, I'm sorry, but that train has left, and you're never going to be on that train. I think it's going to be very, very difficult politically to do that.
I just wanted to answer the thing about the transport, your question. I mean, for example, the LNG, liquefied natural gas shipping, is already much more benign than the current fuel oil that's very rich in sulfur, not just carbon. So but the next stage could be hydrogen for the ships. That's conceivable, renewable hydrogen. It will be a little bit more expensive, but I mean, you also don't want the goods to be transported all over the world for such a low price as it is today. So another point is it's also goods. It's not just the vehicles. By the way, aeroplanes can also fly with natural gas and with hydrogen. So that could also reduce the emissions if it were the renewable source, of course, for the fuels. But I think an important thing that I would like to mention is embodied carbon in the exports and imports in the world trade. If you're talking about the carbon tax, also has to be reflected. So you could imagine, clubs of countries joining together like EU and levying taxes on the imports that are not carbon free, for example. So that would be another way of fighting it. And let me just comment on the urbanization very, very little. You know, today cities account for about 60 to 80% of most of the global resource use, and about 80% of global carbon emissions. So there is no doubt about it that cities are the place. But we also have 900 million people living in the slums. It's not just, as you say, you know, it's a gravity well for everybody to go in. So the cities are, you know, I will not spend more time on it, but it's perhaps one of the biggest challenges that we have, how to make that sustainable.
Three very quick questions. One, two, the lady in the back. Very quick questions. One? No, no,
I have basically two questions, but the first question is, I heard you say that we have to go much faster than we are now in relation to this technological change. As of to reduce the level of contamination. Now, if that's the case, then how much time do we have? Okay, that's one question. The other question is destruction. A nuclear war. How would a nuclear war contribute to the rise of temperature?
Very quick question. Yeah?
Speaking to your point about any change, there are winners and losers. Something I was reading elsewhere said, this big problem in this country is not as much a problem in Scandinavia, because they believe it's okay to tax the winners in order to compensate the losers. And therefore, maybe if we go with a carbon tax, you know, it should include provision for retraining carbon workers as solar workers or something like that.
The lady in the back. This is a good example, a very quick question.
My name is Mel Fandom of the New York City Environmental Justice Alliance, and we're part of a coalition called New York Renews, where we're developing a carbon pricing legislation for New York State. And I wanted to get your thoughts on a carbon tax in New York State versus a cap and trade system that we're also a part of, that is regional, that focuses on the electricity sector versus a carbon price that would be economy-wide. I just wanted to get your thoughts on what do you think is most valuable to really make this transition to the renewable energy economy happen faster, and also if you have any thoughts on the investment side, so not just reducing consumption, but also using those revenues to fund the transition.
Just very, very quickly. So how fast do we need to go? I think that's a key question. So if you don't want to buy the idea of negative emissions, because we cannot do it in some sense. We don't have large-scale, scaled-up facilities to do that. If you want to just do it by reduction, which I think should be the goal personally, then we have to the middle of the century. So, you know, let's say 33 years we have. We just published a paper in Nature a couple of months ago where we were proposing the Moore's Law for carbon emissions, you know, Moore's Law for the electronics, essentially, you know, we could go down the learning curve. Here the idea would be to achieve what we're talking about. This is roughly the paper stylized. Every decade we have to halve the emissions globally. Every decade. So that sort of translates you how much time we have. So that means by, you know, 2030, we should have less than half of the current emissions. By 2040, again, less than half, and so on. So hopefully that answers the question. You know, nuclear warfare, the large scale, we know that from the climate models and other models. That's how some of the, during the Cold War, idea of climate modeling also emerged for this, would be generating opposite of warming, probably cooling, massive cooling through the aerosols and particulate matter that would go into the atmosphere. So it's a really, you know, it's yet another, you know, global destruction. So it's not only people who would be killed on the ground through the nuclear warfare, but there is also a long, long shadow of the nuclear warfare on the whole planet. So that's all I want to say on that. On the, you know, the carbon carbon tax vis-a-vis tradable permits? I think that's an important question. I think many economists would argue that tradable permits are more efficient. I personally do not believe in them that much. We have seen what happened in Europe. I'm in favor of the carbon tax, as long as the other question, as long as the regressive aspect is being compensated. We shouldn't forget that carbon tax is very regressive. It would be unfair to the poor. So we would need some mechanism to offset that, maybe from the revenues of the carbon tax. But I'm for the carbon tax. Simple explanation is that in Europe, we issued way too many permits, because those who emit a lot are usually very powerful. They have influence of politicians, and they manage to wiggle out. Just like some of our large, companies don't pay taxes. So some of the large companies wouldn't pay the carbon, would get the permits for free, wouldn't pay for it. So I think that's really our problem. So we have to figure out. And so I would be for the carbon tax as long as the poor are compensated.
Yeah, I would say on time, we used to talk about mitigation to climate change, and now we're saying that we just have to worry about adaptation to climate change, in the sense that in some ways time is running out for some of the worst consequences of climate change, and we really need to act as fast as possible. And 250 is the time that we've been setting ourselves, but I think, as you were saying, it depends which scientists. I was reading today in the New York Times, French scientists say that we are still on target, and I just read somewhere else, and I said another group of scientists are telling us that the 2 degrees is unachievable. So I would say we need to do it fast as we can. On the other question about the cap and trade versus a tax system, I think the reason it didn't work in Europe was because it wasn't structured properly, the cap and trade regime that they had, and as you were saying, it just issues too many permits. I would say you can have a combination of both sometimes and target different groups in different ways. And I share your view that I think when designing a carbon tax, one has to be very careful about the impact on the most vulnerable in society. I mean, there's one interesting aspect of climate change that we haven't spoken about is the issue of climate injustice. That those that are actually probably suffering the worst consequences of climate change also happens to be the ones that have contributed the least to climate change. And we have to make sure that whatever regime you come up with, a cap and trade or a tax system, takes care of those that are vulnerable, that have not contributed to the problem. They're not penalized twice. Number one, because they're suffering the worst consequences. Number two, because they're paying for something that they haven't caused. So I think we just need to be cautious about it. But the other thing, and the last thing I wanted to say, I think this is exactly what I was talking about, the kind of leadership that we have from NGOs like yours and from states in the United States that are really thinking and leading the way regardless of what is happening at the federal level. So I think there is, to some extent, some optimism about what is going on. And I think, again, we need to start thinking about the opportunities that climate change presents us with, not just the challenges and the negatives.
Well, I think we are coming to the end, and let me thank the team on the Fordham side, the dean, Paolo and others who have initiated and organized from the Fordham side. There's a team from the New School side, Bridget, Julia, Teresa, who's the director of the SIPA, the Schwarz Center, who could not come tonight. Also the dean was originally planned in of the New School and also the research, and he couldn't come in the last minute. So I have to conclude now. It was a good experiment now to combine these two forces, so between law school Fordham and the New School, more from the economic perspective. And we should do it maybe another time with some other combinations. But in particular, I want to thank the two speakers, Naki and Paolo, for all great comments also on your remarks, your questions, and thank you.